I tell you, know it's Harry FM, the superior. They've had a liquor station and nothing but inferior.
Harry FM wishes to advise that the views expressed on the Cutting Edge are not necessarily those of the company.
Cutting Edge is on your stereo, yeah. Mucha peruca leads the way. So just let the station play, yeah. Say your teachings got a hold on me, yeah. Well, this is Kimani, and you're listening to, you know, Mucha Peruca. Harry FM, Cutting Edge. Whoa! I don't know if I'm really rocking it on.
Enlightened people are able to criticize rulers when they see a fault because they are mindless of reprisal. They are able to defer to the wise when they see them because they are mindless of social status. They are able to give to those in need because they are mindless of their own poverty.
Yeah, that was Royal Jamaicans. This is the Cutting Edge, and it's Wednesday, the Pio. Woolly patings are gone, may I tell you. Everything get busy. Everything get busy, man. Okay. So, tonight is a very special program we have lined up here. We have two things on the board here. We're going to go to Ghana. Yes, we're going to Ghana tonight. And then, we're going to present a documentary tonight where you have to have good heart to listen to this documentary. Me warning from now. You understand? Me warning the listeners from now. You have to have good heart to listen to this. In relationship to even where I go on now, with this, the Ebola and the chikungunya and the this and the ganya and all them things. This documentary is to show similarities and draw from history and what history can teach us. This documentary is a gut-wrenching documentary. As we say, trust me, you're not going to sleep. There's no way, no way, I guarantee, there's no way you're going to listen to this and drop asleep tonight. As a matter of fact, you're going to go to bed and have nightmare. But you know, I listened to a doctor yesterday, and the doctor said, sometimes when the people them get fearful, them act to protect themselves quicker. And you know, me and my lady are reason about that said thing there. You know? Sometimes when people get fearful, them act to protect themselves quicker. Because you know, say, if you know, say a thief in your ear, you know, you're going to do all sorts of things to protect yourself. You know, you're not going to open your door wide. You're not going to, you know, them here there, if hurricane come and your feet say they're going to mash down your house, you know, through fear, you put up certain things. So, we want to present a documentary tonight that might strike fear in the hearts of the people, them, but it is there to make you understand that things serious. And apart from that, the documentary will show you that what is going on in Africa now? What is going on in Africa now? It's a terrible thing. But worse than that has happened already in Europe. Because most of the time when we hear about disease and them things, we forget that there was a disease in Europe. We have been mentioning it over a period of time. And the symptoms of that disease is very similar to what we're hearing about now. As a matter of fact, if you check all of the disease them, you know, so all of them have a little piece of something from the other piece, you know. Just check it. All of the disease them we are hearing about, the dengue, the malaria, the Ebola, the chicken gonorrhea, all of them have a little speck of the other one. But we're going to present to you the mother of all disease. This is the mother. I mean, that's a mother. It's the mother and father, sister and brother of all disease. And we have a documentary lined up for you. So we don't want you to go to sleep. We're going to go to Ghana. We're going to talk to a very serious artist from Ghana who came to Jamaica to launch him CD. And him is also a doctor. So we want to go into what is happening in Ghana there also with this thing here that everybody talking about, the Ebola and the West Coast of Africa and all these things. So, and meanwhile we're here that we get two invitations to go to Africa. We are telling people of this problem, we get two invitations to go to Africa. We don't tell nobody which part though. You understand? We don't tell nobody which part. But guess what? We're going to go. All right. All right, we could take the adverts without coming back. Click it. Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge on RFM. You know, I want to heal up me, and I was my program director. And I want to heal up Cabo. And me Cabo knows that I did find the seminar place. And when I went in there, it was about 20 to 30 women doctors and about four men in there. And I was most about the fifth man, and I was the only one in there that was not a doctor. So, you know, so we sit down there amongst all these doctors, and I listen to the doctor and tell them about the disease them. But I find it very interesting, some of the things them where the ladies say, and the questions were asked. And I am wondering if the Minister of Health, I know him is a dentist still, you know, but I think say him should out there. I'm glad I go. And I really appreciate it because it gives me a little insight into certain things and also more able for project what, well, you know, so I'm not going to talk for Cabo though. But I really talk for people who talk for Cabo. It gives me an insight for really understand, make people understand more what myself and Cabo is doing in relationship to our views and what we intend for the people them to grasp from these views so as to make it more, make them more understanding that it's not one thing going around them. It's more than one thing at the same time. And we have to be cognizant that meanwhile we are look over there, so you know. Sometimes we are look too far too. And the thing they're right beside we. You understand? So our intention is to bring the information to the people them. But sometimes the information is very hard to swallow. And sometimes the information go against the grain of what other people's intentions are. But them say, the truth, you must speak the truth. Especially when you're up on the radio, you know. Because if I want, don't believe what you're saying, you know, and I'll say it again and again and again, you know. This is the age of science and technology where you can go by your internet. As a matter of fact, I know some brethren. I don't know if it's Jamaica, though, but I know some brethren in England and in America where anytime this program, their program starts, them turn on them computer and sit down there with them computer until the program finish. Because them hear we say something, them want to verify, them just click, 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 click. And them say, ratted, a true motor attack, you know. Or when them hear we not say certain things, the next morning me look at my email, me see dozens of email about certain things where me should have said, or dozens of email about things where them want me say. And we know say that reach Kabuto. That is why we can go further into the investigation of the things so that we don't depend the most of the time upon our local newspaper. because some of these people is just regurgitating what the American and the British news say. And there are more, there are thousands of different viewpoints coming from different angles that we can investigate. So we don't necessarily have to stop. Maybe nationally, we may can have, you know, read the newspaper and find news. But there are news that sometimes it don't benefit we to repeat international news from these two local newspapers. I try my best and I tell my co-producer them all the while, say, yeah, it is good to get the news locally. But just when we go international, we want to go beyond the two newspapers them. Because most of the time, the two newspapers them are telling you some things where them get off of CNN and BBC. We know that is a fact. So when you hear all Kabu say certain things at Sunday morning time, and you could ask, where she get them things from, Rasta? Because the sister go beyond the news in Jamaica and go dig up some other things. So we try to go investigate, because that is what is the purpose of them said journalism. And we learn that after 20 years Spanish radio, we learn how to go investigate. And when we say the thing, we now say it without authority to say it. We now go frivolous to just say something. So anytime you hear we say something, whether upon this program or the program in the day, it's not trouble we have made to you never hear it before, you know. Because you have some people that say, I couldn't mask it up. I do all of this. The reason why I say that, I've never seen nothing like this in my life yet. So, because him no mosquito in a Jamaica stay now, and this happened to something. We hear all the man up on the TV and say, boy, right now, him no say, oh, mosquito can fly from far over there, so come over here, so, to come do this. So right away, the lack of intelligence trip out. At least the intelligence trip out, because of the magnitude of the situation in a Jamaica. It trip out. So people turn to, me a man I say, boy, right now, me eat every bush on the back of me, me drink every bush on the back of me, and you know, all the rose them, all the flowers them, me drink. You never hear the voice on the TV. You must get a seat for that, sir. The man say, boy, me drink every bush on the back of me, and you know, all the flowers them, me drink. You know? So you see, this thing causes people not only to do extreme things, but to think extreme things, and get superstitious, irrational, and religious. Because in them time, you know, people that say, well, right now, you know, say, actually, the people, them wicked, you know, and we have to turn to God, because if the people, them never so wicked, this should not happen to we, and more people got church now open, say, you know, it will bypass them, like in the days of Israel, when them say, this is try, come around, and just pay the blood upon everybody, and one of the Israelite, them household, because God tell the people them say, every firstborn I go dead. So whether you is Israelite, Egyptian or not, according to the story, if you don't have that mark for your house, the destroyer going to come and murder everybody. I can't murder thing I go on, you know. I want to look at it as murder, you know. Because this destruction of firstborns is attributed to God, you know, the Almighty God. That means say God decides, say, him going to murder every first man to make sure that you mark your house, that when this I don't know is when using, you know, it must say, aha, me have some serious murderer from one of them gang of Jamaica. Yeah. So when he murder everybody and reach a furious son, and furious son, when furious is saying son dead, you know, that time furious said, boy, right now this thing I get too terribly enough. I almost remember the plagues them where they lick Egypt according to what them say, you know. And it's not like say it is impossible for these plagues to hit a country, you know, because is if you follow the sequence of the plagues, if you follow the sequence of the plagues, you know, is the first plague caused the 10th plague to happen. A man better understand that, you know. If you follow the sequence of the plagues, the plague lick the water, the blood the water, and then you find, say, that come out and that come out, it reach the end to the baby, them start there, the firstborn. The DNA of these firstborns, not the secondborn, not the thirdborn, but there's something that is happening that is connecting all of this disaster, these diseases, to the firstborn child of any child. It's like how they make disease for attack black people in South Africa. Can we keep repeating that? I will not have repeated it. They make virus. This is not Muta Baruka. I go on like him. I hear that a madman. And this is reality we are talking about. The doctor of death in South Africa admit in front of the Truth and Reconciliation, edited by Bishop Tutu, that he was creating virus that only attack black people. So it's not an impossibility. That is why you have so much conspiracy theory going around, you know. So when the conspiracy theory starts flying, you know, sometimes the conspiracy theory make people lose sight of the reality of the situation. There are certain things that is in front of you, you know. But because we don't want to accept it as it is, we start to develop some theory, conspiracy theory. It's not that conspiracy theory must be wrong, you know. Because not because it's a conspiracy, it is not true. But sometimes, and I find that the majority of the time, conspiracy theory don't lead you to be rational in the reality of the situation. It make you feel like you get rational. But sometimes the conspiracy theory draw you away from the reality of the situation that confront you. And when you start to get in the conspiracy theory, most of the time, it's religious people that define that reality. Most religious people define that reality. And then now you start to get into some God doctrine. We say, well, it's God that do that to the people, them, and it's God that did this, and God that did this, and God that did that. Tonight, we're going to play a documentary that show you how people lose touch with reality because of a devastating disease that lick Europe in the 14th century. That's about 700 years ago, I think. And we're going to show you in this documentary how a disease can upset a continent that people now don't even recognize Europe and recognize that this happened to Europe. But now it's Africa. It happened in Africa. And according to the statistics, I know them say 4,000 odd people dead, and them say if it continue, you're going to have 10,000 affected people in a week, every week. And it's going to peter down, you know. Can't never go on so all the while, it raised up already. You remember when the AIDS thing did come up, you know, everybody did scared, you know. Everybody did all that. I said, well, we don't want to touch a man, and the man realized, well, you can't touch a man and get it. And the superstition and the enmity between people develop, you know, because a man feels, if a man who have AIDS come beside you, you are going to catch AIDS too. And you could have never, in the 90s, you know, you couldn't tell some people, say, if a man have AIDS, you saw, it's not going to catch it, you know. So, you know, a man has started, you know, man, two man says it's gay disease. Man decides him want to kill every year, you know. Because them say, gay people bring this power, you know, a judgment, you know, to the Bible, tell you say, must kill them, and this and this and that. So, in a day, euphoria added something. In a day, the reality added something. Unreal thinking start to manifest itself. And people start to get so crowded in them illusion and imagination that them start to attack specific people in the society, because them feel it's that specific people cause it upon them. Therefore, they have to get rid of that specific people. And if you realize, say, it never did work. Because the thing still there with me, but it's just that the euphoria don't dead with me again. So we reach a stage, you know, where Ebola come. It's not the first it come, but it's the first, you know, it come upon the earth in a this way. That now it starts to spread across borders. And that is the problem now, when it starts to spread across borders, you know. But guess what? This did happen in our history already. But why you know that this is happening in history already, you know? And people did feel it's the end of the world. And trust me, we don't know what going to happen. But them said Jamaica prepare for this thing, yeah? Ebola. But who to tell? Maybe we are looking around the corner for Ebola, something else is round the corner there. I wait for a Brian to laugh to hurt him. Brian's imagination is going wild. Meanwhile, when they have to think about Ebola come from, it's a minus bowl. You understand? So, we don't know. But all we have to do, as you said now, we're up on the radio, we have to present the case, we have to try to find answers. So we don't just bring you and show you the problem. We have to try to find answers to this thing. And that is where we are using the program there for the know. We are trying to find answers. And we are trying to make the people understand and say, look here, man, this is a serious thing. This is a serious thing. Can you imagine? Anyway, we're not going to make you imagine nothing yet. But you hear me, I say now. At 11 o'clock, we're going to connect to Ghana, talk to the brethren, and then we're going to play this documentary where I tell you about. As me, I said, trust me, Brian, you like O'Brien loves sleep. Brian, I guarantee that Brian will queen to my tonight when him hear this thing. I click it. Yeah, this is the cutting edge. We're playing a tune here with that instrument we had. Well, not even hardly. You know, hear nobody I use it again. You have to go to Africa and hear this instrument there. They call it xylophone in the West. And as we say, it's not an instrument where you hear in a music, but remember, I said it used to play. Here's a Jamaican, I use it there with an old tune. Long time jazz tune, he make it to over big tune. Lenny Hibbert, the late Lenny Hibbert, Village Soul. Xylophone music, sweet, just light, you know, not heavy, you know, you have to touch it light, yes. I know some man make that instrument there with strips of glass too, you know. Yes, I see some man will make the xylophone with strips of glass. Yeah. Very, very old music them there. From them time there, you understand? Village Soul, Lenny Hibbert, late Lenny Hibbert. We want to heal up. Serious thing. We want to heal up. Bonnie and Scully, and we want to yell up Deadly Headley. Yes, Deadly Headley. We're going to visit Deadly Headley yesterday. Yes, the man they blow a saxophone from before me. Ban. Right, and we say them things, you know, it comes straight to me, considering my age, you know, me, all the man, when we tell a man, say, I realize I'm gonna play or I sing before me born. It sounds weird to me though. That means say the man they are in the 80s. 80s are that go down to them 90s. Yeah man. But unfortunately we hear of a death. Styles Cat, who used to play with Roots Radix. A brethren will start, well, in leader. A band named Dub Syndicate, we have toured the whole world, especially Europe. The man they not stop tour Europe. Dub Syndicate, appear dub music them play. We're going to find out somebody tune them tonight at all for play. Dub Syndicate. I hear that them go find him dead in a yard in a Manchester there. You know, so that is the next thing to go solve. Find out who kill him, why them kill him. You understand? Styles Scott, the man they found them time they don't have Orange Street there. and play music and tour the world. Israel Vibration, Bono Wheel and all them man the man I used to back, especially from record. Okay, here we go. Yes, big tree is about to fall. You know, today a woman who have the Ebola virus take a plane and go visit somewhere and come forward on a said plane there. And then them go find out, say no, she really have the Ebola for two. So them have to now call for everybody where did fly on that plane there with her. To report, to see if them get affected. Them go sanitize the plane. What about in America, you know? In America, them fly. She fly. I don't remember which part. Them said she fly go. But she fly go somewhere and come forward and she did have the fever. Them test her and it was 99 degrees. You understand? 99 degrees she did have that fever. And she fly upon the plane. Now, them a call for everybody who did fly upon the plane. But yeah, so the thing with it is now, you know, that apart from calling for everybody who fly upon the plane, you know, you have to call for everybody who fly upon the plane, for everybody who those people who fly upon the plane come in contact with. I saw the thing run. This is not AIDS, you know. This is not AIDS. This is sweat, saliva. All them shake and business there, I forgot done with, you know. All them shake and thing there. Remember that? Well, it's a serious thing. But it left you and it makes you feel almost uncomfortable. You know, it's like you're in the world, but it makes you feel uncomfortable. But we don't know if anybody feels so. It's like you just feel uncomfortable. Because here's you know in a little island there, so now. And everybody have friends say, please don't make Ebola till them start to despise other country. And Africa is like the pinball, you know, where a man has said, no one got Africa again. Imagine Zimbabwe, the way over the other side of the world. I mean, from evil, Liberia and Sierra Leone and Guinea. And a man have a show in a Zimbabwe and him say, he might cancel the show to protect him fans. I say, Zimbabwe, I know you have no case of Ebola in a Zimbabwe, of all the places, Zimbabwe. The way over the other side, thousands of miles away from over there. So. And hardly any plane that fly from over there so, and go over there. So. But a woman take a plane in America. So, we are trying to figure out the psychology of this thing, you know, because the psychology that say, why, if you do it there in the West Coast, you know, but me not go Africa at all, because you never know when somebody could have reached over Zimbabwe or South Africa or Kenya or them place there, and you come in contact with it. Well, we not serious problem, you know, because you know the distance from here so to Dallas or Colorado or Nebraska or Hawaii is much nearer than the distance from Liberia to Zimbabwe. No, me not tell a man say him no fi say where him a say I do where him a do, you know. But me a wonder if people now fall in a little trap. In a little trap. Because me a man ask a really announce. Me a man ask Jerry Small this morning. Now that Africa say that we him still want to repatriate. And this way it reached out. Yeah, I said, tell me something, Jerry. Like all the whole if I bowl at the Africa though, you still want to repatriate. So me I say, alright. we who recognize Africa as our motherland, we now see something where at the track we from saying Africa, and now you trap me, do you know? And now they trap me. But not only that, I am wondering if now you trap me, do you know? And now they trap me. But not only that, I am wondering if, because remember, say, Liberia, Guinea, the mountain ear traffic. I mean, I try justify nothing yet or no, but it's just a rational, because really and truly, these things, as me just said before, you know, it make you get irrational. It make you start to think superstitious. This is the time when more people go and go turn to God. And it make you start to look for other people disgustingly. You understand? So, me I look at this thing and me I say, there's more aeroplane I left West Africa to go into Europe and America. There's more Africans leaving America, leaving West Africa to go to America on a daily basis than who left West Africa and go to East Africa. Because most of the time, nobody wants to go left to West Africa to go to East Africa unless it's a businessman who depend on a seminar or some business journey or thing. You see, him say, I'm going left Sierra Leone to go to, you know, Kenya or Uganda or these places. People don't just go there because in family is in Zimbabwe. People family they America or people family they are France or Germany or Spain and all these places. Now, may I say, if all of these places, since Africa is not a country but a continent, and America is a continent, but it's also a country. It's like how Australia is a continent, but it's also an island. Only for people don't know that Australia is an island, and it's also a continent. It's one of the seven continents. Understand? All right. The distance from here, so, to Dallas, and not only Dallas now, but the places where those people who come in contact with those people travel to in America. Anywhere in America, those people went. The distance from Jamaica to those places is much nearer than the distance from West Africa to East Africa to South Africa to North Africa. The distance. The likelihood of a person traveling from West Africa to Europe is much more than a person traveling from West Africa to East Africa. Normal, like how we yes or no, we want to go to America and we want to go to England. No, a normal Jamaica don't want to go to Morocco. You see, you have to be enticed to want to go, or you don't want to go to India unless you find a little girl where you say, well, I take your care, you go to India. You say, oh yeah, Jamaican, go to India. The normal Jamaicans don't go to Australia. You see, you have to have money to go to those places. And the normal Jamaican don't go to, where is that name, another place that people, I mean, they just don't go to certain places. It's only certain people go to certain places. Like what the Prime Minister said, mandatory, she don't want none of our parliamentarians to go to West Africa. Okay. Given that the distance where we have between Jamaica and anywhere in America, is nearer than the distance from Jamaica to East Africa to connect to West Africa. Are we going to start to get bombed to go to America? That is the question. Will we now say, why it's not Dallas, you know, me not go to Miami, you know? Because here they know, a woman who in a Dallas take a plane and go to a next state. And now they call for all the people them who depend on a plane there. For come in, come get tests. And those people must have been in contact with other people. And the paranoia begins. Because they wasn't supposed to have no more cases but the African. And the other cases, them say them get better. So they have to fly everybody now go Atlanta. They have to fly everybody who them five things have Ebola now to go Atlanta. Because them say the two, where they reach there, so get better. And now them are them give blood now to the people them. To somebody who did have it. I think the photographer. Because they say if you have it one time, you know, I'll catch it again. So the virus, it's like it build up a resistance, so you can now transmit your blood to a person who have it, and then it fight the virus in the next person. Meanwhile, them say them think them find a cure. Tomorrow we're going to find out if there is a cure already, but them don't want to use it, because we have a woman we're going to interview that made a suggestion to the Nigerian government. I will play a little 58 seconds our voice last week. My, we're going to play it tonight again if we have any time. But will we now say, because we hear artists say them are going to Malawi and them cancel that. We hear artists say them are going to Zimbabwe and them cancel that. If you look on the map, Malawi, they way over there, so Zimbabwe, they way over there, so, and Liberia and Sierra Leone over there, so, Jamaica. Eh? The man there? All right. So, Jamaica is just 1 hour and 18 minutes from America. And anywhere in America, you go, the farthest distance you can go in America will take you 5 hours. Which is Los Angeles. It will take you 5 hours to reach over there. So the distance between traveling from one part of Africa to the next part can it take you much more than 5 hours. If there is a case in Nebraska, if there is a case in Hawaii, if there is a case in Dallas, and now we don't even know if it's only Dallas that case is now. One man died already, two more people. If that woman travel upon a plane and go to a next state, and now they call for all the people them who go up on that plane, 100 odd people in on the plane, if you come in, come get this. Are we going to say now that, why you want to say, me no know if me go to America, go do no more show in a Rasta? Because you see that plane flight where that woman they take? Oh, me know, say the people there, me no go walk them up in the airport. And they might say, oh, are you Mura Baruka? Yes, I shake, man. Oh, man, I very wanted to see you, man. Right at the big airport, they start shake off, man. I'm going to figure out on the flight. What a preke. My granny used to say, my mother used to say, to, what a preke in the earth, you know. What a preke. Blessed. Yeah. Hey. Lante?
Yeah, hello.
Lante?
Yes, sir.
This is Muta Baruka. Why, it looks like you're so. I don't want. I don't want you to listen to your radio because you want to hear yourself on the radio in Ghana. You know? Why you listen to me on the phone?
Yes, that's what I'm doing exactly.
Yes, so listen to me. Don't listen to the radio. Make all the people in Ghana listen to the radio. Well, why you and me are your time?
All right.
We must call you. Dr. Lante? What's your first name? What? How you pronounce it? K-N-I-I. How you pronounce it?
It's Nii.
K-N-I-I is Nii.
Yeah, Nii.
Nii Lante.
Yeah, so the K is silent. And then yeah, Lante.
Okay, the K is silent. So it's Nii Lante.
Yes, sir.
All right. And you know, is that also a doctor?
Yes.
What kind of doctor you be?
Well, orthodox medicine, and I did internal medicine. I specialized in internal medicine and therapeutics.
Okay, all right. So we want to talk about your two levels now, but we're going to talk about the music. What doctor from Ghana become a reggae musician that you come to Jamaica and make an album? Give me a little short history of that. How you decide that? Well, I know you decided still, you know, but, you know, the reggae music, you come to Jamaica, you make an album, it's a beautiful album. How you come to that?
Well, you know, I've always liked to play music, you know, since I was younger. And even through medical school, I had always music as my passion. I mean, everybody in school knew that it was music I really wanted to do. And when I qualified, I just couldn't let it go. Because I had so many things to say and nice things to sing, you know, about. So when finally I finished specializing, I said, okay, now let me do what I really want to do. So I started playing the music. But somewhere along the line, I met a Jamaican man who was living in Ghana called Robert Beaumont, or Ken Beaumont. And he had heard some of the songs I'd done, you know, some of the songs I'd been doing in the studios, underground and stuff. And he was like, look, Nii, you have to go to Jamaica because the kind of music you're playing, I mean, Jamaica is the place, that's the foundation and everything. And I was like, yeah, I mean, I'd be glad to do that. So he came back to Jamaica, and then he laid the foundation, made the contact with Mikey Bennett and Mr. Dean Fraser, and I was able to raise some money, and I came there, and then the album was done.
You actually had the launch in Red Bones?
Yes, I was.
You know, I was supposed to come at a launch there, you know, but I get caught up in something else. But, you know, I heard that it was a wonderful launch.
Thank you. Yeah, we were expecting you, but I understand.
Yeah, I know you didn't expect me, but I got the invitation from the brethren to who line up this interview, that's all, from Donga Ocherios, that's all, but I couldn't make it, but I never make it, but now I have you here by the radio, that's all. All right, so tell me something now. The CD is in Ghana itself, it is now here, just in, I mean, well, it don't look like it's in Jamaica, really, but have it been released in Ghana?
Well, it's been, we're doing promotions in Ghana. We wanted to do a launch, but we had a whole lot of logistical problems, and then we decided that we were just going to come out with singles until such time as we put the launch together and then bring the CD out, the CD out.
So reggae is still vibrant in Ghana, because I know years ago reggae was like a thing. Is it still as active as it was like 10 years ago, 20 years ago?
Yeah, very, 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 very vibrant. You know, the reggae and dancehall scene is really catching up.
Yeah.
And, you know, you know when you were in Ghana, I actually came to the concert, man.
You mean years ago? Yeah.
Yeah, but it was you and, I think, Yellow Man.
Yeah, Yellow Man. Come there.
Yeah, but I was there live.
So what
was the concert?
Yeah. Tell me something. Black Rasta, him the party radio, him all that call me for something. Him still the party radio. Him still the party radio down there.
Yeah, Black Rasta is still on air. But I think he's gone on a short break now.
On the
party show. I've been hearing for some time. Yeah, I think he's touring or something. That's what I heard.
You're serious? Black Rasta.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Alright. So you make this album and it released. You say you're doing singles, just singles are fight in Ghana.
Yes.
So what about the European market?
Well, we're trying to get into that market as well. I'm working with multi-brand and synergy production to try to get into the European market. So as for the business side, I mean, I've left it to them to...
All right. So you going to like Alpha Blondie, where you take Jamaican musicians and tour with them, because that's Alpha Blondie used to tour with pure Jamaican musicians. And I don't see me no more Jamaican musician. I don't know it's what happened still, but the people.
Yeah, I mean,
you can't speak.
That would be great. I mean, to talk with Jamaican musicians and to talk with Ghanaian musicians and African musicians as well. You know, we're same one and the same people. So
yeah,
you know, I know Alpha Blondie.
Used to tour with a lot of Jamaican musicians in the early days there. And as a matter of fact, Alpha Blondie actually came here and made two albums.
Yes, I remember very well.
Yeah, two albums. Jerusalem, yes. Big album, yes. So I guess you're on the part. No, I guess you're on the part like Alpha Blondie here.
they play the trail and we follow, you know.
Yeah, man. I will love that. Is Ghana you come from, too, you know, because you know Ghana all a sweet place in our heart. You know, when we talk Ghana, our heart light up in a more ways than one, you know.
Yes, give thanks.
Yeah, all right. They show them. Which is the latest? Not latest. Which is the last Jamaican act come to Ghana? The last one.
The last one I went to. I think Ja Vinci is the last one I remember. But the last one I was personally at the stadium to watch was Mavado. Mavado.
Oh, yes. Mavado came down. That was when last year.
Yeah, that was around last year,
yeah. And the response was wonderful.
Wicked. It was very good.
Yeah, the man of the wicked. Very good. Wicked. Or African, you know, take up all the dance in the Jamaica, can't go to Ghana, you know, watch it, you know. Me like your tune still, you know, Big Tree. The Big Tree tune is sweet.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, man, and me like your tune. Me like your tune upon the, I don't know if I ever should have said tone, you know, but I like the vibration where you give. And I say, I don't know why, but I don't know if it is, I don't know if I should do it, but you have an Alpha Blondie kind of vibes to me. Believe you me. I don't know if I should have said that to you, if it's an insult or what, but, you know, you have a kind of Alpha Blondie vibes where I feel, I can't see you out upon a whole heap at the festival them in Europe, and really, I push up vibes out there, you know, and I hope say that will happen eventually, especially next year, because by next year the CD is supposed to well seep in. I hope that your people them are getting it into Europe fast.
Yeah, that's the prayer, man. That's the prayer. That's what we're praying for, you know. And I mean, it's always a privilege if when you know you're being compared to a trailblazer, a big person in the music industry. I mean, I've heard comments like, I think a little bit like with Avandros, a little bit like maybe this, Alpha Blondie, a little bit like Alpha Blondie. So
somebody tell you already. Somebody tell you say you sound like Alpha Blondie. Well, you know, it's not song you sound like Alpha Blondie, you know. Is the lyrics where you are spewed and the vibration we get from the music. It's not, you don't sound like Alpha Blondie no way to me. It's just how, when I listen to the CD, it's how you are put together the lyrics. And I can't see, I can't actually see how perform the lyrics them, you know?
Yeah.
So you start to show in Africa. You start to do any show in Africa, you start to tour Africa, or you just in Ghana?
Well, it's just beginning. I've done a couple of shows in Ghana, and last year I was invited to Nigeria to play at Celebration. Now, that's a big concert in honor of Fela Ransom Kuti. That's one of the biggest musicians that came out of Africa, you know, in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah, I know that. I know.
And I was invited.
We play with Fela already in Nigeria, in the shrine. We go down at the shrine, go play. Me, I'm a musician there, man. Yeah, man, I'm a bridge in that.
Yeah.
Fela, oh gosh, man. The time when we go down there, we got about 21 wife.
He had how many wives?
When we went there, he had 21 wives. Yeah, all of them put
Yeah. Fella was known to do that. African, you know?
Yeah, all right. Let me ask you a question now. The reggae music that you play, I know to say, you're still older, and I love it because as I played the Black Tree a while ago, I see you still maintain that high life, them call it, that kind of Ghanaian rhythm. It's like you have fused the Ghanaian rhythm with the reggae on the Big Tree tune, where I just played a while ago. You never go fully reggae, but you maintain that. I mean, love that. Explain that to me.
Thanks. What actually happened was that, you know, like I was saying again, we always give thanks for, you know, the elders in the music and our fathers and uncles and those who give us direction and guidance all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was actually recording the song in Jamaica. Yeah, I was recording the song. In my mind, I thought it should be like a strict reggae song.
Mm.
But then Dean Fraser was in the studio.
Ah.
And he listened to the song and said, why don't I rather infuse more of the Ghanaian and, you know, back home Africa kind of rhythm into it. And I was like, oh man, you know, it was a shock because that's not the idea at all I had. But then he was producing it.
Yeah.
And I said, I mean, why not? I mean, this is what the whole thing is about, you know, reinforcing the African personality. So I said, let's do that. And believe me, when we were recording it, we really had fun in the studio, you know.
Yeah, man. And but Dean Fraser know what I'm doing. You have to listen to Dean Fraser. Trust me, you have to listen to him.
I tell you every time.
Yeah. All right. We're going to come forward and we're going to talk to Dr. Lante. So if you can get Dr. Lante on the phone, we're going to come back and talk to Dr. Lante. This is The Cutting Edge. Yeah, this is The Cutting Edge on IRFM. We're there with you.
Only for you, girl, I'll be good.
Yeah, listening to Neil Ante, artist just arise up in Ghana. You're going to hear a lot about this artist. Him have the vibe, trust me. Yes, sir. We're there with you still.
Yes, sir. I'm here.
All right. So, always Ghana facing the Ebola thing, man?
Well, you know, thankfully, you know, we haven't recorded an official case yet. I mean, once in a while you hear a scare that, hey, we think we've got a case here, but whenever it's tested, it's negative. So far we haven't had it.
But Ghana is on the West Coast. One would feel that when we hear don't go to the West Coast, it will include Ghana too, don't it? Because Ghana, they're on the seaside, they're just like Liberia and these places.
Exactly, but Liberia and Sierra Leone and Guinea, they are more towards the tip.
Yes.
The most western part of Africa, they are more towards the tip. And Ghana is more getting to the end of West Africa, on towards the right side, on getting towards the, you know, the
reason why I I don't want to cut you, but the reason why I asking this thing is for the benefit of Jamaican people. Because
yes. It's very important. I mean, it's very important.
Geographically, we're talking now. All right. Sorry. You know,
exactly.
Yeah, all right. In May, we went to Gambia, and we were supposed to do Gambia, Ghana, Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Senegal. But when we reached Gambia, the booking agent says that them cancel the show in Guinea and Sierra Leone because of the Ebola. And then we heard that, I think it was Senegal and Nigeria closed their borders, not allowing people to come across the border from Sierra Leone. But we went to Senegal. And in July, we went to Nigeria. The only thing I heard about in Nigeria was Boko Haram and the 200 girls and that Boko Haram steal. I heard nothing about Ebola in Nigeria. That was in July. All right. Ghana, Nigeria, Sierra Leone, Senegal, Gambia, Liberia, all of these places is defined as the west coast of Africa. And you are saying now that you are in Ghana and you have not heard any official Ebola patient in Ghana.
No, not at all. Not at all. I mean, so is Ivory Coast. Ivory Coast hasn't recorded a case yet.
But Ivory Coast is next door to Liberia. Ivory Coast is next door to Liberia, don't it?
Yeah, just, yes, exactly.
Ivory Coast is where Alpha Blonde come from.
Yeah. I mean, they haven't recorded a case yet. Togo hasn't recorded a case yet. Benin hasn't recorded a case yet. Nigeria is containing it. Cameroon hasn't recorded a case yet. So it's not like the whole of West Africa is, you know, Ebola infested.
Yeah, the way you know it's Africa, you know, but, so anything of anything that look make Africa look terrible, it will be like that. You know, I mean, you are in Ghana now. You was in Jamaica, and now you are in Ghana.
Yeah.
And you are saying that there's no case of Ebola in Ghana. And I know that. I have been speaking to some people who know of people in the Ivory Coast, and they are saying that, and I, if you look on your map and see where Ivory Coast is from Liberia, you'd have said Ivory Coast must be part of this epidemic too. But there's no official case of Ebola in Ivory Coast.
No, Ivory Coast hasn't recorded one yet.
So how is that possible?
At least.
How is that possible? How is that possible that such a devastation is going on in Liberia and Guinea and a country that is next door has no official case of it, and Ghana has no official case of it, Mali have no official case of it, Togo have no official case of it, Benin have no. How is it possible that this is happening considering the magnitude of this disease?
Well, you know, talking from like the medical point of view.
Yes.
No, I'm just from the medical point of view. I mean, there are a couple of scenarios that can come up. I mean, one of the scenarios is that, I mean, there was a source of the outbreak of the disease, and it is now spreading, but because of maybe certain things and certain programs that are being put in place,
mm-hmm.
it is being contained.
Yes.
You know, now, a lot of the countries around West Africa have become highly sensitive to the issue, you know. So,
yes.
So the immigration laws are becoming stricter.
Yes.
You know, we are screening people at the airports more and more. The borders are doing that as well, both the airports and the land borders. And cases are being reported more, you know, as more people die and it looks scarier. I mean, in the regions where it's happening, I mean, they begin to appreciate the magnitude of the problem and then report to their hospitals earlier.
Yes.
Initially, quarantining was a big issue because people didn't really understand why they should be quarantined. They didn't really understand the mechanics of how the thing was transmitted, etc. But now, now that people have really died from this thing. Now, I think people are coming on board more with basic things, washing your hands before you leave. If you've had any contact with any dead body or join a funeral service or something, or if you've gone to town, you've come into contact with so many people, just wash your hands when you get back or use a sanitizer and things like that. I mean, basic health things which we already do, but we haven't been doing, we haven't been really adhering to strictly.
All right, you know,
so that could be one of the scenarios.
Yeah, you know that, I'm supposed to speak to somebody tomorrow about how Nigeria has been able to contain this Ebola thing, and considering that Nigeria have the most people in Africa, the population of Nigeria is more than any other country in Africa, yet still they were able to contain it. As a matter of fact, when I went to Nigeria, I was expecting to spray my body with that other thing for mosquito, and not what, I mean, this is serious, and I'm not exaggerating. Not one mosquito bite me in a Nigeria. That I have to go to the authorities. I have to go to the authorities and say, 30 years when I went to Nigeria, a man named Steel Pulse went with me to Nigeria, and everybody went back into England with malaria. And I am saying, I am talking to these authorities, and I say, what did Uno do? What Uno do? Because I walk on road and I still see dirty water. I still see water that is puddled up from the roadside, disgusting.
Exactly.
I ask him, what you know do for make I come back to Nigeria 30 years after and I don't feel, it's like a vet trying to feel a mosquito bite me. I say, Nigeria, I mean, the mosquito supposed to bite me. Not one. Them say, well, them have a program and this spraying thing. Is what them do. Them section out the places in Nigeria. Like, you know, one era, them spray over there, one era, and tell the people them say they must spray over there. So, and them have people who go around. It's a job. It's like they employ people to suppress
exactly the
mosquito thing. And I mean, not saying that it mosquito caused the Ebola, but I am seeing that they have done something in Nigeria to contain this Ebola, and I have to find out what they did to contain it. I have to find that out. Because they were... That was one of the countries that would have exploded if that Ebola ever get to in a Nigeria, considering the population, especially in a Lagos. Oh, gosh, man. Lagos is the most confusing place in the world. I mean, I'm sorry for saying that, but it's true. It's the most confusing place in the world. It's not like Ghana, it's spread out. Ghana spread out, little, but I know you've been to Nigeria. You've been to Nigeria, right?
Yeah, Lagos, man, Lagos is rough. Lagos is rough. Yeah. But you know what you're saying, eh? What you're saying is, I think it may be, because when I was in Nigeria for the celebration too, thinking about it, eh? I don't think I was bitten by mosquitoes that much. Surprisingly. Now that you're saying it, you know, I'm casting my mind back, and I'm like, this thing, because I didn't come back with malaria. I don't remember having been bitten. Then we were outside every time, you know, we're at the concert at night, and all that. But it's food for thought. You know, and maybe I'd listen into the program too tomorrow and hear what.
All right, you see.
I was just saying that when we heard about Nigeria having recorded its case, you know, it was the same panic thing. We're all like, wow, if Nigeria has it, because Nigeria is big, you know, the population is so big. And Ghana has a lot of interaction with Nigeria.
Yes, definitely.
Nigeria has it, but they've done a very good job, at least so far, you know, of containing this, and we must just learn from their example and you know.
Yeah, and I have a brethren who I was speaking to him but sharing email, and him say it was just in Nigeria and the Ivory Coast doing business, and him we now to Kenya and Ethiopia. Because he's a businessman, and him say, man, we went to Kenya and Ethiopia, and it's like it not budge. It's like wow, oh, this thing go. I mean, this is West Coast, man. Ebola match from the whole of Africa, West Coast. Oh, you did it, not go on, like, not go on. So I know you know as a doctor. I come tell me, you know, say it. Ghana is in the West Coast. You're not supposed to be saying these things. People is dying West Africa.
No, it's not. Well, I mean, it's spreading.
It's terrible.
But, you know, we don't have a kid. But you know, Muta.
Yes.
One thing too that I think I'm noticing is that this outbreak has taken, it has started, well, and it's more concentrated as of now, in the countries who've had a lot of problems over the past few years, and probably they have had some problems with their healthcare systems. You know, like, I'm talking about political instability.
Yes, yes.
You know, like Liberia, we know they had a long, drawn-out civil war.
Civil war. Sierra Leone, a big civil war.
Exactly. Yes. You know, and then Guinea was having a series of coups and,
yes,
you know, and all that. So, I don't know. Maybe it's related to failing healthcare systems as well, you know,
yes,
or the thing thriving within that kind of a failing healthcare system.
Yes.
This is just something, an observation that, yes, I'm making. Yes. May not be true, but
as a doctor,
that I think.
All right, you know, it is reaching America in a very serious way. This Ebola thing is now in America. A woman was flying on a plane, and then when she come off of the plane, them find out that she didn't have it. So now they are now, them sanitized the plane, and now they are calling on the 100 odd people who was on that flight to come in, make them test them. Yeah, I don't know if you heard about it. Did you hear about it? You heard about it?
Yes, I heard about it on the news.
Yes.
And I mean, it only goes to show that this is not an African thing, you know? Initially, you know, all these countries had cold feet, you know, nobody wanted to really respond to the issue, but
yeah,
now,
yes,
I guess they have no choice.
Yeah, I hear Obama say no, that it's not Dallas, it's ground zero, it's Liberia. So if them want to contain it in America, they have to contain it in Liberia. That is where them dead
oil.
You can't talk about America now and live out Liberia. So if you want to stop it, you have to stop it in Liberia. Because the going to and fro of people going to cause a devastation. You know?
So, exactly.
All right. So did you know that there's artists in Jamaica that have show in the East Coast and cancel it because of Ebola scare?
No, I'm not too aware about that.
Well, I am telling
that's
you.
I'm listening.
Artists are showing Ghana and Malawi and South Africa, and they cancel it. Say they're not coming because Ebola. Ghana.
Yeah, I knew there was an artist who was supposed to be performing in, I think, Ghana.
Yes.
Recently. But I heard there was also an outbreak of chikungunya or something. I think it's a virus.
In a Jamaica.
In Jamaica, yes. Which he then had. So it sort of... But then they also mentioned the fact that the Ebola thing may also be a contributory factor to why the show may not be able to come on, you know. So I've heard something like that.
No, but it's the artist them stopping the show from come on. It's them is the main act, you know. It's them stop the show from come on because of the scare of the Ebola in East Africa.
Wow.
Freddie McGregor have a show in Kenya, and Freddie McGregor said not canceling the show, I'm going to Kenya. You have a portion of artists just left Kenya and Uganda in East Africa. But you have artists where it's saying that they're not going to Africa. Not just West Africa, you know, them not going to Africa.
No, but I don't think that is too right. I mean, it's not like the whole of Africa.
I do your laugh because it sounds weird to you. I know it sounds weird to you because it sounds weird to me too.
But you know the funny thing? You know, I mean, the businessmen who are coming in from the west?
That me just a tell.
To do some exploitation.
Bridging,
yeah, coming,
bridging.
You know?
Last week, me said the same thing. Now me said, look here. Meanwhile, when you say on the North Africa, whole heap of white people who are the business are going in Africa.
Exactly.
The plane them still go to Africa.
Yeah, I mean, you come to the airport. I mean, come to the Accra airport and check out the flights. I mean, they're still coming. They are coming in their numbers, man.
Brethren, no guy. Me absence. Me know, say me not for go certain place because the chance is much more. But we have chicken gonorrhea down here, so. And me not hear about them just have a big concert down here with about how much art 3-day appeared soul artists that come from America. None of them never cancel them show. None of the artists them never cancel the show down a Montego Bay. Them call it Soul in the Sun. All of the artists them where them put on the posters to come perform for about 2 days down at them the appear America them are coming from. We are in a crisis in Jamaica with this thing called Chick V. And we are told that the majority of the population going to get it before it start to decrease. Right? All right. Now we hear of a disease in America named D68, the edge of virus disease, where kill already over 6 picnic and reach 45 states and gone in Canada now. We don't hear nobody. I warn the people them about people coming in into Jamaica with that virus, especially children. We see the Ebola is the worst thing ever happened right now. Because we're going to show the people them said the worst than that today, you know. So we have to prepare ourselves for this thing, yeah. Because the way people are traveling now, anything is possible. But for demonize Africa in the way that we hear people are saying, you know, the Naga Africa. It's like, it's a freaky thing to me. It's freaky.
Exactly.
Anyway, Bridget, we give thanks for talking to you still, you know. Give thanks for talking to you, Bridget.
Yes, man. Yes. It's a pleasure, man. It's a pleasure. You know, you were one of the musicians, man, that I really was into when I was in school back then, man, Charlie. So apart from the interview, Charlie, I'm really giving thanks for, you know.
Yeah, man.
For the trail you blazed for us to follow as well.
Yeah, man, give thanks, man, give thanks. And I say, we're going to continue playing this tune, them tune here, because we love the CD, as we say. And, you know, we always like when we hear the African, them come out in a full force to really deliver the music, especially when it is done in reggae, but them don't give up them Ghanaian consciousness. So we give thanks. Dr. Nilanti from Ghana. Which part are you there, Accra?
Yeah, Accra.
All right, sir. So give thanks, brethren. Give thanks, yeah?
Thank you, too, boss.
Yeah, man. Forward.
Truth has to be spoken to justice.
Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge on RFM. As we are saying, we are going to the deeper part of the thing, you know. Because we not take what them are telling you, you know. You understand? We have sense. We have sense. And African people are not idiot. Okay, so we tell some of our players tape away. It's just weird. It's just dangerous and weird and fearful and scary, given what is happening now with this disease. Why I run from roadside, come inside. I run from outside, come inside. You have to be a road like Ebola, I run me down. But Africa has been through many trials and tribulations. Europe has also gone through trial and tribulation. The only thing is that we who's here now, if you don't dig deep, you might not know of certain things that take place in history. And what we here is to do now is to unravel these things and make you aware that these things is happening, that you can protect as near as possible. Can we hear some people know some things with this chicken gonorrhea thing that we wonder if it's like in the dark age today. It's like what we are going to listen to, you know, people in the dark ages, where they might tell you all sorts of foolishness. And you try to show them the reality of the something, and they might say, how come I get them foolishness from? You know, see? And then, instead of you believe the real thing and do something for protect yourself, you hear all the council them in St. Mary. I say, after them I try to get the people them to clean up the place. The people them I say, where they might clean up place, so because of the mosquito cause it, then you tell me, say, no. The nastiness is mosquito for going to make you clean up now. The council that they might try appeal to the people them for clean up St. Mary. And the St. Mary people them are talk about say, I know mosquito cause it there for them, no matter, it no matter to them. So what? So what that mean now? Mosquito is not a danger whether or not it's chikungunya or dengue or whatsoever. It's a terrible situation. Listen. Listen to this.
First impulse is to run. And when there's no place left to run, pray. Pray like there's no tomorrow. Because for the people dying all around you, tomorrow will never come. No one knows where to hide, how to save themselves, how to survive. Bodies beyond number. Storm of violence and madness. The terrible vengeance of God. It is the Black Death of the Middle Ages. The greatest biological disaster in the history of mankind. It is, as one witness testifies, the end of the world. At the dawn of the 14th century, Western civilization is riding a phenomenal streak of prosperity.
Europe has had three, maybe four centuries of really good times. The church has been strong, various kingdoms have been strong, trade has grown. Cities have grown, industry has grown, there haven't been any natural catastrophes, weather's been nice, population's been growing. It's really been a nice time for Europe.
But this long expansion is about to collide with a new reality.
Suddenly, global climate patterns shift. Temperatures plummet and crops fail. Startling swiftness, the golden age collapses, and visions of the apocalypse come true.
The four horsemen of the apocalypse have come. Famine hits, plague hits, war is all over, and death is all over.
By the 1340s, war ravages the continent. The deepening crisis hits peasants hard. But nobles see an opportunity to make their fortune in the escalating chaos. At 33, Edward III of England is a seasoned ruler, and his island kingdom is not big enough to contain his ambition. In August of 1347, Edward's army wins an improbable victory at Calais. In August of 1347, Edward's army wins an improbable victory at Calais over his much wealthier rival, Philip VI of France. Edward now controls much of the French seacoast, but the conflict is far from over.
This is the beginning of the Hundred Years' War, and of which is really a world war as far as the Europeans are concerned. It involves everywhere. Spain, Germany, Italy, France, England.
King Edward promises his daughter Joan to Pedro, the Prince of Spanish Castile. It is a match meant to extend his reach as far as the Iberian Peninsula. For a marriage between the two royal families will redraw the map of Europe and make Edward's line the mightiest in Christendom. Barely 15, Joan has never met her fiancé, nor has she ever been to Spain. Like any young girl, Joan dares to hope her father has chosen a handsome prince, perhaps even a kind one. Miles to the south, in Avignon, France, Pope Clement VI, God's representative on Earth, considers his own prospects.
For 1,000 years, his Holy Catholic Church has lorded over king and peasant alike, the greatest power in the Middle Ages.
The religion of a medieval person was their life. It surrounded them. They thought nothing of going to church every day. Their life consisted of a lot of blessings which they attributed to God and cursings which they kind of attributed to God too, although they blamed it on their sins. So their whole life was enveloped in this religious atmosphere.
But in the 14th century, the church's seemingly impregnable facade begins to crack.
Priests were coming under a lot of criticism for abusing their power. We have lots of examples of priests who had concubines, priests who slept with women in the village, priests who were considered corrupt.
Even the Pope seems tainted. The French have hijacked the papacy, moving it from Rome to Avignon. The break with tradition seems to suit Clement VI, a worldly man who enjoys his opulent lifestyle, but it scandalizes the faithful. Despite the skeptics, Clement's word still carries absolute authority. But will it be enough to sustain his flock when the world comes crashing in?
Questo è un messaggio urgente per il chirurgo. Sì, sì.
The one man who will prove to be his most trusted and courageous advisor is his personal physician, Guy de Chauliac.
He's the medical practitioner of great renown. He had been in court medical circles since the reign of Philip the Fair around the turn of the 14th century, and now he is the attending physician, so to speak, of the Pope.
In de Chauliac's world, religion rules science. So entwined are the two that a medical degree can only be earned with a master's degree in theology as well. But neither his medical texts nor his Bible will prepare de Chauliac for the horror to come. Far to the east, on the Mongolian steppes, something terrible has awakened. An invisible agent of death. Rumors fly that all of humanity is being wiped out in China, India, and the Islamic world.
Interestingly enough, these rumors of origins in the East are accompanied by apocalyptic descriptions of the plague's origins. There were miraculous events that occurred, a rain of frogs, serpents, and so forth. There was a rain of hail and thunder and lightning. And then finally, stinking smoke and thunder fell from the heavens.
Before 1347, the Mongols seem unstoppable. Their dominion over the East has lasted nearly 150 years in an empire stretching from the peaks of Tibet to beyond the Volga River, and from Beijing to Constantinople.
Essentially, they opened up trade between Western Europe and China. People could essentially follow routes that went through Central Asia, so that the second half of the 13th century in particular was a time for expansion of European trade toward the East.
But as the Mongols make the world a better place for business, they also plant the seeds of its destruction.
Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge on RFM, and trust me, this is the building up to one of the most devastating. You know, they no mention not go Africa and this thing, huh? Yeah. Apparently, this never reached Africa. Can you believe it? Let them say it's a world thing. Even though them say world war, you know, says Europeans that kill Europeans. It's like when the Americans say them have the World Series, and it's only America involved in the World Series. The time is 12 o'clock, midnight in Jamaica.
With Mota Baruka, we are listening to the whole of it. You know, here, cutting edge, the edge, the edge.
Yeah, you know, man, I talk about the Mongols. It's a group, it's a tribe in Asia named the Mongols. And we're going to continue the journey to this thing. Well, yeah, we're going to continue.
We have very valuable goods and cargo, such as spices and silk, passing along this overland route opened up by the Mongols through their unified empire. But of course, another commodity would have been plague.
Relentlessly, the pestilence creeps across the steppes, wiping out whole villages. The bodies swollen with malignant sores. In this harsh wilderness, nothing goes to waste. Valuable goods like furs and blankets are always salvaged. The rest is torched, an attempt to kill the evil that caused this tragedy. But the unseen demon travels with the loot. In 1347, thousands of miles to the west in the bustling trade city of Geneva, a servant prepares to make a dangerous journey. In a society defined by the doctrines of the Christian Church, he is already at risk. His name is Agamemnon, and he is a Jew.
Jews had to have that explicit invitation and permission of the king to be in a town. They were, in a way that no other medieval person was, owned and directly dependent upon the king or a great noble like a bishop.
At his lord's bidding, Agamemnon will venture hundreds of mountainous miles to Venice, where he can purchase luxuries which are unavailable in the common market stalls of his home. But his expedition also takes him into the darkest events of history. In England, 1,600 miles to the west, a rider is approaching the end of another daunting journey. A troubadour has traveled for weeks all the way from Spain. He is a gift from the Prince of Castile, sent to amuse his betrothed, the English Princess Joan. He will sing her songs of love on her wedding voyage to Castile. A romantic gesture for the pleasure of a young girl. On the way to Castile, Joan and her entourage plan to stop on the French coast and visit their estate in Bordeaux. A favorite among the 12 children born to her father, Edward III, Joan has lacked for little in her short life. On this momentous voyage, her dresses alone require an entire ship. Along with many distinguished clergymen and diplomats, 100 bowmen will make the journey to protect this precious cargo. But their precautions will come to nothing. Within a year, almost all of them will be dead. Even now, the invasion has begun, carried on the lowly backs of small stowaways. A ticking bomb, it will bring this beautiful world crashing down. Trade routes opened by the Mongol Empire now encourage the spread of goods, people, and pestilence into the heart of Europe. Travelers on the road, peasants in the field, and even the daughter of the King of England are all speeding towards an inevitable encounter with the greatest killer in the history of mankind. The Black Death. At the end of the Mongol trade routes lies the port city of Kaffa on the Black Sea, starting point for merchant ships en route to Italy. In 1347, the Mongols attacked the Christian city of Kaffa, hoping to take this vital trade link for themselves. At first, it seemed as if the town will fall to the relentless assault. But in the heat of hostilities, the Mongols suddenly confront a virulent new enemy, plague. It inspires them to launch a final desperate plan.
The Mongols got the plague and had to call off the siege. But before they left, they decided to catapult their dead corpses, their dead bodies of their victims into the town in order to, quote, extinguish everyone inside and give the plague to their enemies. And apparently this is how the plague was communicated by the Mongols to Europeans.
It just may be the first incident of germ warfare in recorded history. While the story might be more legend than fact, the Mongol pestilence spreads to the townspeople of Kaffa.
The plague is fairly slow-moving for an epidemic disease. In 15 years, given the vast stretches of the steppe and the thinness of the population, would be about the right time to get it to Kaffa.
But while these facts seem clear, a mystery remains. After such a slow beginning, how does the plague spread to Europe so fast? Many historians believe it hitches a ride on merchant boats bound for Europe. And its first port of call is the island of Sicily. To the people of the shore and inlets of Italy, the waves have always delivered up the odds and ends of the Mediterranean storms. But this year, something different washes ashore. Ships from the Black Sea sail into harbor, bearing something foul. Below decks, the Italians find a cargo of corpses. The few survivors are reported to have sickness clinging to their very bones.
Mio Dio, che male è questo?
When the townspeople realize the danger, they try to banish the plague ships from their harbor, but it is too late. The plague has already taken hold, and the dying begins. This is no ordinary illness. It is disgusting and painful. Its victims fall into terrible fever and dark despair.
Initially, it would have been difficult to tell the early symptoms of Black Death from a very heavy flu-like, what we would consider to be flu-like symptoms. Fevers, chills, and the high temperature. And then there would be a second stage where the development of the welts, the swelling of the buboes.
A painfully enlarged lymph gland in the neck or groin. They become black and can swell to the size of an orange. It is these buboes that suggest bubonic plague may be the cause of the Black Death.
It's spread, I mean, very, very rapid. It can cause septic shock. Blood pressure will drop very rapidly. See multi-organ failure. The vascular system can become leaky and you can have hemorrhaging. The buboes themselves are very, very painful. It's a very awful way to die.
Like pioneers in death, the people of the Sicilian town of Messina soon discover that this new disease is not only awful, but also highly contagious. It quickly spreads within families, sowing terror in every quarter.
This more or less struck out of the blue, and nobody had seen anything like this. So these people were like, they were like Columbuses in the land of mass death. That's just what they were like.
As the plague rages through the Sicilian town of Messina, the survivors have only one place to turn. The Holy Mother of God. Those still able to walk, trek to her shrine 6 miles away and carry her back to the city.
Santa Madre, proteggici da questa malattia in nome di Cristo.
Despite their urgent pleas, the Virgin refuses to help them, according to the Italian chronicler, Michela di Piazza.
The arrival of the statue profited nobody. The Messinese were so loathed and feared that no man would speak to them or be in their company, but hastily fled at the sight of him, holding his breath.
Visibility of the disease, it marks an individual out as having that disease, and that's very important in terms of creating a social stigma.
Though the Sicilians shun their Messinese neighbors, they cannot outrun the disease. The mark of sickness leaps across the island with startling speed, and the horror has just begun. Already are the Genoese ships from Caffa are landing on the Italian mainland. They bear furs, textiles, and rats. All fine purveyors of death. Like an avenging angel, the plague will sweep across an unsuspecting continent as the apocalypse begins. Faces the greatest threat ever known to mankind. Swift and deadly, it seems to come from nowhere and everywhere. As it reaches Italian shores, people are utterly defenseless. For medieval science is mired in a fog of superstition and ignorance. Guy de Chaliac is surgeon to Philip VI, King of France, as well as Pope Clement VI, who resides in Avignon, France. Renowned for his great intellect, he has been trained by the best physicians in Europe at the monastery in Montpellier. His techniques, like bleeding with leeches, are all designed to restore balance to the body.
There actually were medical theories about the balances of elements, about what kind of balance the body needs in order to stay healthy. And the plague, from a medical point of view, was seen above all as a reversal of all the normal balances.
Conveniently, an unusual alignment of planets directly precedes the outbreak. To the medieval mind, it is a logical explanation for the imbalance.
The conjunction of the three planets, Jupiter, Mars and Saturn, that created noxious vapors within the air. And it was these noxious vapors that interacted with the individual constitution that caused somebody to succumb to the plague.
This was the miasmatic explanation, or that the plague came from a miasma, an evil vapor. And I should emphasize that these explanations were not new. They were very old.
And so entrenched that it is almost impossible for the medical community to depart from this way of thinking. Away from the elite power centers of Avignon and Paris, in merchant towns like Geneva or Venice, common people have less elaborate theories about the source of the plague. They've been indoctrinated since birth to believe that, like all blessings, curses all ultimately flow from God.
In the Middle Ages, the entire logic of the relationship between God and the world involved God punishing the world when the world sinned.
Punishment is well deserved, according to 14th century Italian chronicler Gabriele de Musis.
Almighty God saw the entire human race wallowing in the mire of manifold wickedness, enmeshed in a wrongdoing. pursuing numberless vices, drowning in a sea of depravity because of a limitless capacity for evil. We now know that it was not sin or evil that brought on the Black Death. It was a contagious disease. The question is, which disease? 600 years later, historians and scientists are still looking for an answer.
What the key question becomes is how those diseases become transmitted and propagated, and what is it in society that enables a set of different causes of death to emerge at one point in time.
For more than a century, the main theory has been that the Black Death was caused by bubonic plague. Caused by a bacterium called Yersinia pestis, it is carried by fleas and requires a very particular environment to flourish. In many ways, medieval Europe seems to fit the bill.
Urban centers, garbage on the streets, tremendous milieu in which to breed huge rat populations. And with those huge rat populations, huge flea populations.
A single flea bite injects the victim with Yersinia pestis bacteria. They quickly multiply in the lymph nodes, filling them to bursting. Once released into the bloodstream, the bacteria causes the black welts that give the Black Plague its name. And there is another, even deadlier form of the disease, called pneumonic plague. It needs no flea to spread its poison.
In some instances, the bacteria will go to the lungs and lodge there and begin to proliferate. If you cough and you have also hemorrhaging in the lungs from the bacteria, you can get what's called a bloody sputum, where your spit has blood, flecks of blood in it. And if you're coughing, those respiratory droplets can be quite infectious, and then you can infect another person.
Both the environmental conditions and disease symptoms suggest bubonic plague was the cause of the Black Death. But some scientists vigorously disagree with this theory. They point to one inexplicable and compelling fact: the shocking speed with which the disease spread.
Basically spread across Europe, Western Europe, within 4 or 5 years. It's incredibly rapid spread, considering that they didn't have trains, planes, automobiles, that the transportation was by foot or by horseback. I mean, it's a very, very rapid spread of the disease.
Many doubt bubonic plague could travel so fast.
The speed at which the disease spread around communities isn't consistent with what we know about bubonic plague. So this has led some historians to suggest that perhaps there was another causal mechanism involved, there was another epidemic disease involved. Perhaps one suggestion has been the spread of anthrax. Other authors have suggested it might have been an Ebola-like virus. There are clear differences here in relation to the way in which disease is spread.
Why does knowing the truth about a disease that happened centuries ago concern us today? Quite simply, understanding the Black Death could be critical in our fight against mankind's next catastrophic outbreak. But until recently, it has seemed that the clues to this mystery died with the plague victims. Or have they? In Montpellier, France, a 650-year-old mass grave is giving modern technology the chance to pick up the scent once more. A contemporary team of French researchers exhumes the bodies of plague victims, breaking new ground in a new scientific frontier.
Black Death studies are still young. It used to be thought Black Death couldn't get anything out of a skeleton. It was a tissue disease. All we have are the bones. Couldn't get anything from it. Now with DNA, with some of the other things that we can get out of bones, there's some possibilities. Still very, very controversial. There's some possibilities that we might learn more and more.
The researchers are mining for biological treasure. The teeth
of plague victims. Like a locked box, a tooth seals in the DNA of organisms traveling in the bloodstream at the time of death, including, perhaps, the very agent of death.
You are listening to Muta Baruka.
They took the teeth out of the skulls. Then they examined the tooth pulp for evidence of the presence of the plague bacteria, Yersinia pestis. And according to their results, these sequences were obviously Yersinia pestis DNA, but they were somewhat unique. And it provided the only really objective evidence that we have that the Black Death might indeed have been caused by Yersinia pestis.
The French results bring the mystery of the plague one step closer to its solution. But more study must be done, more graves investigated. The scientists' work will continue. To Guy de Chaliac, eminent 14th century physician, the concepts of deadly fleas and bacterial DNA would sound as unlikely as ill-crossed stars and God's wrath sound to us today. Yet all he has are his charts of the stars and his own quick wits. To die with the greatest peril the human race has ever known. By the autumn, the Black Death has made its way from the Far East and is sweeping over Sicily, leaving panic in its wake. It is a disaster without precedence, as if God himself has deserted his children. In Venice, Agamet, the Jewish servant of a Swiss lord, finds all that his master desires. Saffron and cinnamon, silks and furs, and more besides. For late in the year, merchant ships from the east arrive bearing a cargo of death. 14th century Italian chronicler Gabriele de Musis gives voice to the horror of the sailors who have unwittingly brought the eastern catastrophe home.
To our anguish, we were carrying the darts of death. We were spreading a poison from our lips even as we spoke.
Of course, they didn't have any idea that the plague was spread by a bacterium, by a microscopic organism that can't be seen by the naked eye. But they did have a sense and a knowledge that the plague could be spread from person to person.
As Agamet heads back to Geneva, the world behind him begins to fall apart. Venetians are dying at the astonishing rate of 600 a day. In January of 1348, the plague enters France through ships trading at Marseille. It sails over water to Spain. In Barcelona, 60% of the population perishes.
You can imagine a person, let's say a sailor, working in the dock area, being bitten by an infectious flea. They would get on their ship, and then they could travel on their ship. And they wouldn't become sick for, again, 2 to 6 days. So there's the potential for people to move around, move from one area to another before becoming ill. Of course, the same ship may have rats with infectious rat fleas. And then when the ship reaches a port, those rats and their fleas can get off and spread the disease as well.
By early spring, the Black Death travels up to the mouth of the Rhone River to Avignon, where the Pope resides.
Vigneron, je vous en supplie. Я молодец, frappe la porte. Docteur, mother per mia protégée.
Though Guy de Chaliac urges him to flee, Clement VI reportedly refuses to leave his palace. By August 1348, the plague reaches Paris. Half its population will die. lands in Bordeaux. England's Princess Joan is just arriving from her sea journey. She will rest at the family estate for a while and then continue on to Castile and her prince. Joan is perhaps the most well-guarded woman in Europe right now. But archers and castle walls cannot shield her from an unseen enemy.
No, no! No! Vous ne pouvez pas passer ici! No! C'est trop dangereux pour la princesse!
By the phantom, the pestilence strikes randomly, wiping out a household, a neighborhood, an entire town. Even before it sows destruction, it breeds terror.
There was nothing they could do. And it's that sense of facing an event over which you have absolutely no power that makes it such a dramatic event in human history.
I've often tried to imagine what it must have felt like to hear that in the town across the mountains, 75% of the people had just died. And what they did hear, they received letters before the plague came. They knew the plague was coming in many places. So they had time to think about what's going to happen when it gets here. And I can't really imagine a scarier thought.
Consumed by fear, many of the gentry flee the cities, leaving the less fortunate to fend for themselves.
What we see in literature are these cowardly figures, the rich who are going into the countryside and who are there frightened by their own mortality. So who's left behind? Who is back in town suffering but the poor and those who are unable to do what the rich can?
In England, Edward III and his eldest son retreat to a country estate, bolting the gates behind them. But the wholesome atmosphere does not seem to protect the serfs who farm the land. They die by the droves. In the fields, on the roads, and in their miserable hovels.
People lived in extreme poverty, and they lived in huts with thatched roofs. They had livestock living in very close association with them. They had dirt floors to the huts. The living conditions were absolutely filthy. In such environments, we expect rats and rat fleas to proliferate and do quite well.
Born in Lionel Town, Clarendon, this very technical high school graduate was trained in the field of auto mechanics. After completing the course, however, he lost interest and made the choice to become a music entertainer. He'll be my guest this Thursday afternoon on Easy Skanking from 12:15 to 1:15. He's Diego Jr. He's the young man with a song, Powerful Minds, which has been getting the nod of approval from listeners. We find out more about his own meditation this Thursday on Heart, Mind, and Soul to Serve.
And test the soul and element. Show the wicked pleasure. Lightning.
You hear that?
Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge. We're on a journey here trying to show you something in history and say, oh, we can learn from that history. It has happened in a terrible case before, and now we see this thing, this scourge has penetrated Africa, and we is running up and down, up and down, up and down. But I think, say, this documentary is supposed to be listened to because it shows some very striking resemblance to what we know call Ebola. When I say that still, but as we said before, all of them diseases seem to have something related to the other thing. You know, you hear about the coughing, the fever, the swelling, and, you know, it's like at least one something in other one day, and the next something in another one day, in another one day, and the next something in another one day, in another one day. It connected. But this one, yeah, what we are presenting as you know, is something where if you take a stack of, really, can you imagine if the chick V was a dead thing? Don't ever imagine that. Because Jamaica is 3 million people. You know, we are talking about that thing where we are presenting, you know, millions of people. Millions.
As conditions worsen, the church too seems to fail its flock. Fearing contamination, some priests refuse to administer last rites to the dead. For medieval people, to die without last rites is a more terrifying prospect than death itself. But as the death toll mounts and more priests succumb to the plague, the Bishop of Bath makes a startling suggestion.
If they are on the point of death and cannot secure the services of a priest, then they should make confession to each other, to a layman, or, if no man is present, even to a woman.
In these grim days, self-preservation usually wins out over heroism. Not even family ties can bind the healthy to the sick, as one of the great writers of the age, Giovanni Boccaccio, witnesses.
Relatives were cared for not otherwise than dogs. They threw them their food and drink by the bed, and then they fled the household.
One person would get sick first, the family might start to take care of them, maybe friends would come and help, but then others in the family would get sick, and you can imagine that very quickly people would abandon any attempt to help each other.
When you have every third person dying, this of course is going to affect people's outlook and mentality. One of the responses would be fear. Am I going to be next? Is the plague going to strike me? Can I get the plague even from my father, my brother, my sister?
The lack of compassion appalls Sienese chronicler Agnolo de Tora.
Father abandoned child, wife, husband, one brother, another. For this illness seemed to strike through breath and sight. And so they died.
The death rates were so high that basically people's faith was shocked or rocked to the core. Many of the teachings they'd been given by the church didn't seem to give them any comfort or seem to be applicable to the situation. Everyone was dying. It didn't seem to make any sense.
The very fabric of society is unraveling, and no one seems to know how to weave it back together.
This was God's vengeance on humans for their wickedness and sin. What better way to respond to that than by an extraordinary penance that would take away that sin?
So, in their terror, the people turned to religious zealots who whipped themselves in a brutal imitation of Christ's own suffering. Their fanaticism will lead the crowds further into hysteria, persecution, and mass murder. In 1348, the Black Death has traveled from Sicily to England, carried in trade ships aboard the backs of rats. Already it has claimed the lives of millions. In every village, in every farm, the corpses pile up in staggering numbers, creating a new crisis. How to dispose of the dead?
If you lose 10% of 95,000 people, think about that, that's 10,000 people. How do you bury 10,000 people that have been lost in a very short period of time? Where do you find the people to take them? Where do you find the people? Where do you find the carts to take them?
The only people who were willing to carry away the dead were these very rustic, uncouth men or women who came down from the mountains or from the surrounding countryside, who were willing for very high fees to take away the dead and have contact with the dead.
The smells must have been very difficult, and people tried to accommodate that by having fires and, you know, having sweet smells around. They tried to cover up the smell of death, but you can only go so far with that.
In the summer of 1348, graves must be found for nearly 300 people a day in London. The situation is even worse in Avignon. In 1 6-week period, 11,000 people are buried in a single graveyard. The Pope is finally driven to consecrate the Rhone River. Countless bodies are committed to a watery, unmarked grave. But perhaps even that is preferable to an Italian mass burial.
They would lay it like layers of a lasagna. They would put the bottom layer, sprinkle a little dirt, a second layer, sprinkle a little dirt, third layer, sprinkle dirt.
In Siena, in the Tuscany region of Italy, the toll is literally unbearable. Fully half the population is reported dead. Siena citizen Agnolo De Tora raises a lament that has lost none of its poignancy after 6.5 centuries.
In many places, great pits were dug and piled deep with the multitude of the dead. And as soon as those ditches were filled, more were dug. I, Agnolo De Tora, buried my 5 children with my own hands. And so many died that all believed it was the end of the world.
In spite of the personal risk, some brave hearts hold fast, combating the mounting crisis.
You are listening to Muta Barruca.
Many doctors have stopped seeing patients to save themselves, not Guy de Chauliac.
He stayed. I think there was not just bravery, but a certain scientific curiosity there. He wanted to see what this great blazing demon was and how it worked.
Guy de Chauliac seems to do what a more modern medical practitioner would do, which is he doesn't understand the disease, so he takes part in helping individuals with the disease until he gets it, and then he writes about it.
In his remarkable journal, the careful surgeon catalogs all the symptoms of the disease while making note of which treatments seem to be most effective. In the summer of 1348, Guy de Chauliac is said to have prescribed fire itself as a preventative for Pope Clement VI. 4 great basins of oil and wood are set ablaze on either side of the Pope's throne, a fortress of flames against the ravages of the plague.
It gives us this image of the Pope running from society, so to speak, sequestered in an interior room that is now blazing hot with fires built up around him. Clement formed his own hell, if you will, in order to keep out of Clay's reach.
If your dominant medical theory of disease causation is the miasmas and the bad vapors in the air, then if the smoke given off by the fire has a purifying effect, then clearly that makes some sort of sense in terms of warding off infection.
Whether by fire or luck, the Pope survives the plague. But Princess Joan, the favorite daughter of the King of England, does not. Like almost half the population of Europe, she falls victim to the Black Death. father, Edward III, is powerless to do anything but mourn.
Destructive death, who seizes young and old alike, has lamentably snatched from us our dearest daughter, whom we loved best of all.
All the Trapman's authority have just disappeared. And you see one human being, one grieving human being, and he's speaking to another person, and it's a voice that's immediately recognizable 700 years later, despite the trappings of authority.
All authority, medics, clerics, nobles, fail. And so the masses turn elsewhere for salvation. Along the Rhine region of Germany, the faithful decide to take matters into their own hands. They are known as the Flagellants. Fanatics who think they can win God's mercy by imitating Christ's bloody passion. Is an extreme measure for an extreme time, and people flock to them in droves.
People looked upon the flagellants as helping to ward off the disease, as perhaps their extraordinary penance might avert God's wrath and take away the plague.
The notion of flagellating oneself might have a particular appeal, a very dramatic method of, painful, dramatic method of scourging oneself of the sins in the expectation that you might not be alive tomorrow.
In groups as large as 1,000 men, the flagellants commit themselves to a master for 33 and a half days to mark their Savior's years on earth. Forsaking bath, bed, and sex, they piously march from city to city, performing gruesome masochistic acts before appreciative thrones. In his journals, the French chronicler Jean Divinet writes,
"The penitents scourged themselves with whips of hard-knotted leather with little iron spikes. Some made themselves bleed very badly between the shoulder blades, and some foolish women had clothes ready to catch the blood and smear it on their eyes, saying it was miraculous blood."
Pope Clement VI, however, feels threatened by their growing influence.
The flagellants were suspected by the organized religious establishment. They're coming to a place, often created a lot of commotion, and sometimes it was accompanied by even movements against the town authorities or other groups. Religious reform, too.
As the plague progressed, one senses that all the institutions in medieval society, including most notably the church, were shown to be as powerless as, you know, they were just like everyone else, as the poorest peasant.
This juggernaut will be hard to stop. The medieval masses are ready for a miracle, and the flagellants seem ready to deliver.
That's what the flagellant processions and the sermons that attended them created. This moment of heightened, messianic, apocalyptic, now is the time expectation.
In 1348, a maelstrom of hate more vicious than even the Black Death itself erupts. Shock gives way to a witch hunt. Someone must be responsible for this catastrophe, and they should pay. In a torrent of hysteria and fear, the crowds target the helpless and innocent in a bloodbath of biblical proportions. In the mid-1300s, the Black Death is rushing toward its apex. Already it has cut a path of destruction from Sicily to England. Convinced that God is punishing the world for its wickedness, the town set out to purge themselves of all forms of sin.
The first thing they would do is pass urban reform ordinances. No gambling, no swearing. Put the prostitutes out in a house in the countryside. Clean up your act. Maybe that will avert the plague.
Bene, bene, bene. Questo non deve succedere mai più.
E voi, seguiteci. Per voi e per le ragazze è tempo di prendere una
vacanza. Towns of Pistoia, Italy. Town fathers combat the plague with new laws, changing the treatment of the dead.
Ordinanza numero 3. I cadaveri non potranno essere rimossi dal luogo della morte prima che vengano chiusi in una cassa di legno. Ordinanza essere rimossi dal luogo della morte prima che vengano chiusi in una cassa di legno. Ordinanza numero 5. Che nessuno abbia l'ardire di portare cadaveri all'interno della città. Ordinanza numero 30. Durante i funerali le campane non potranno essere più suonate.
You are listening to Muta by
Tolling
Ruka.
The funeral bell, once a comforting sound to mark the passing of a loved one, has become an incessant reminder of a world gone to hell.
So many people dying that you might have a priest might be leading one procession, a procession of one person to a grave, and then he would look behind him and he would see 10 more that he would have to accompany to their grave. So there was a mass death, so much death in fact that people in a sense became inured to it or hardened to it, that now funerals became the occasion of witticisms and jollification.
But in Germany, the escalating death toll brings out something even worse in people. The extreme violence of the flagellant movement. Their violent self-punishment, complete with the suggestion of holy blood, creates a sensation as they travel through a countryside empty of hope. Their dramatic displays are far more compelling. Ineffectual mutterings of the village priest. The flagellants focus the people's fear and rage on a tangible target, the local church.
Welcome.
Believing their bloody sacrifice earns them God's grace, flagellants claim to perform Christ-like miracles.
Some flagellants believed that dead babies or dead children could be revived in their midst. There's also a famous story of a cow talking as a miracle ascribed to the flagellants.
Along the Rhine, it seems as if miracles are being performed. While in Avignon, France, the very heart of Christendom, 400 people are dying a day. Pope Clement VI knows the flagellants pose a dangerous threat to his authority, but his cardinals urge him not to do anything hasty. They fear an attack on the movement at the peak of its popularity could cause a backlash against the church itself.
There's an interesting dynamic between the popular attitude towards the flagellants and the authorities' attitude towards the flagellants. The authorities tended to take a hostile stance, but the people, on the other hand, seemed to have supported the flagellants, largely because they associated their arrival with a warding off or averting of the plague.
Blah. Clement can do nothing to quell the insurgency. And the movement is about to take its ugliest turn.
These processions could be experienced by ordinary people, ordinary Christians, as a totally transformative moral experience that uplifts them and that makes them feel that they have the strength and the energy to make their city or their town a better place. Whatever that takes. It may take swearing that you'll never gamble again. It may take throwing the prostitutes out of the city. It may take expelling the Jews or even burning them.
Jewish merchant Adamat has traveled through hundreds of miles, devastated by the plague. But ahead of him waits a greater horror, a bloodbath of epic proportions.
It's human nature, I suppose, to look for a scapegoat in times of crisis. Jews always seem to be the scapegoat, and in the Black Death they were as well.
For the flagellants, it is an easy leap from criticizing the church to attacking the Jews. For the medieval Christians, no one offends God more.
There is a whole history of blood libels against the Jews, a whole history of persecution of the Jews by Christians during the Middle Ages.
Betrayed by his distinctive clothing, which marks him as a Jew, Adamat is taken to town officials for questioning. He is not alone, according to 14th century chronicler Jean Divinet.
The infection and the sudden death which it brought were blamed on the Jews, who were said to have poisoned wells and rivers and corrupted the air.
Was war denn eigentlich im Beutel drin?
Ich habe keinen Lügner. Keinen bekommen.
Lügner. Du hast Schlüssel vergiftet, nicht wahr? Lügner. Lügner.
After hours of torture, Adamat breaks down. He falsely confesses that a rabbi did give him a pouch filled with venom, which he used to poison the wells.
They were forced to confess that no Jews are innocent. All Jews are guilty. They're all part of this conspiracy. No one can be clear of these charges.
Divinet reports that confessions like Agamet's fly up and down the Rhine.
Accordingly, the whole world brutally rose against them. And in Jewish communities, many thousands were indiscriminately butchered, slaughtered, and burnt alive by the Christians.
Poisoning us is the Jews' presence itself. That the Jews' presence is a moral failing. It's our sin to tolerate them, and this is what's bringing this punishment.
As Pope Clement VI pointed out at the time, Jews were dying in equal number to Christians, so it was fantastical to argue that Jews were poisoning people during the Black Death.
The Pope's pleas fall on deaf ears. On St. Valentine's Day, 1349, the citizens of Strasbourg round up as many as 2,000 Jews and burn them at the stake. The atrocity is repeated in more than 15 cities in Germany and Switzerland. The people of Europe have been poisoned, not by some insidious Jewish plot, but by fear, hate, and ignorance. The lethal combination is spinning out of control, even faster than the Black Death. In the winter of 1349, Christians in Germany, France, and Switzerland turn on their Jewish neighbors in a horrific massacre intended to appease an angry God. But violence cannot stop the grim progress of the Black Death. In Avignon, nearly all of the nobles have fled the city. Even the Pope retreats to his country estate, no longer trusting in his protective wall of fire. Only one man. number of his court stays behind, the renowned physician Guy de Chauliac. But the aging surgeon's final investigation of the disease comes perilously close to home.
Guy de Chauliac continued to make the rounds during the plague in Avignon to the point where he himself came down with the illness.
And even on his deathbed, he doesn't quite know what it is that we've got. But he's willing to help people. He's willing to try.
De Chauliac's heroic commitment to his patients has brought him to the brink of death. No one knows better than he how slim his chances of recovery are. As the heroic doctor struggles for his life in France, the flagellant movement in Germany starts to fall apart. Originally made up of pious zealots, the flagellants now attract outlaws. They greedily hoard loot stolen from the churches and openly consort with rowdy women.
One gets the sense from some of these stories that in some of these villages, the flagellants were almost treated like rock stars, and that there might be what would be after flagellant parties. The sight of the blood, the stripped down bodies and the sweat and the lean muscular frames and all of that, no doubt aroused many young female peasant hearts. That and the fact that you just had so much emotion loose in that at that moment in time.
It is simply too much. The authorities finally move against them. In October 1349, Pope Clement VI calls for the flagellants to disperse and is roundly ignored.
The church actually has to look to the political means of stopping the flagellants. The flagellants begin to be arrested or they begin to be chased away by military officials.
Some masters, now called masters of errors, are even seized and beheaded.
Wir befinden dich für schuldig. Du hast Unglauben verbreitet. Du bist zum Tode verurteilt. Soll Gott deine Seele schützen.
Even with the flagellant movement broken, much of Europe remains violently hostile to the sadly diminished Jewish community. The survivors become refugees, searching for a safe haven.
Most of Europe, France, England, large parts, many German cities, had no Jews by the end of the 14th century. They'd expelled them or killed them. But in some places, Jews were being given greater protection by monarchs and invited to settle, and one of those places is Poland.
In 1349, Poland is ruled by King Casimir the Great.
The legends are that he fell in love with a Jewish woman called Esterka, Esther, and it was out of love for her that he issued this bull of protection to the Jews of Poland and invited more Jews into Poland.
One of the ironies is it pushed the German Jewish community toward Poland. And 700 years later, that sort of came full circle again with the same group of Germans.
In the winter of 1349, the plague pushes north to the Scandinavian peninsula. By the time it reaches Russia, 2 years later, the crisis is over in France. After wiping out almost half the population of Europe, the plague itself is sputtering to an end.
infectious diseases have these natural cycles that they go through until that cycle is broken, either by human agency or by, for example, a change in virulence of the infective organism itself.
As the Black Death proceeded and as the humans began to die and society, you know, that it was falling apart, basically, it's possible that the human numbers dropped down below a certain level and that these outbreaks can't maintain themselves.
The magnitude of the final death toll is so vast that it strains the human imagination.
I think the plague was unprecedented in the scope of its mortality, and I'm of the opinion that the mortality was higher than most scholars are willing to accept. I believe that the average mortality was close to 50%. Not a third or 30%, as most scholars claim.
Urban centers and religious communities have suffered most. 60% of Venice has been swept away in the epidemic. In Avignon, half the citizens are dead. At the monastery in Montpellier, where Guy de Chauliac received his training, only 7 of the 140 original monks are left. England is reported to have lost fully 2 million souls, a third of its total population. But Edward III, King of England, survives, as do other nobles who've taken shelter on secluded country estates.
There's a somewhat lesser death rate among the upper classes, partly because they could move. They could leave an urban area, they could leave a town, they could go out. Their castles or their manor houses might provide an environment that was a little less conducive to the contagious nature of plague.
Pope Clement VI, who deserts Avignon during the worst outbreak, is also alive and well. More amazing is the recovery of his surgeon, Guy de Chauliac. His journals record his words.
Towards the end of the plague, I developed a fever with a swelling in the groin. I was ill near on 6 weeks. When the swelling had ripened, I treated it with figs and cooked onions mixed with yeast and butter. I escaped by God's grace.
Oh, c'est un miracle, mon ami. Il faut que nous allons prier.
But for many, survival comes with a terrible cost. Having lost so much, they question whether life is still worth living. Ibn Khaldun, a 14th century Arab historian, fears that evil times are ahead.
The plague swallowed up many of the good things of civilization and wiped them out. The entire world changed.
Think about the impact of losing 15 million people, what that does to society, what that must have done to the church, what that must have done to science, to medicine, to art, to literature. What if you lost a Da Vinci in there? What if you lost a Leonardo? What if you lost a Michelangelo because of the Black Death?
You can look almost anywhere and see the traces of this loss of a third, a half of humanity. I read one tombstone that said he died in the year when scarcely a quarter of humanity was left on Earth. This sense that you're part of a fragment, 25% remaining, that's it.
This is the only time in recorded history that every single person in the known world, without exception, has watched their closest loved ones die in agony. The sorrow and isolation devastate the Italian poet Petrarch.
Consider what we were and what we are. Where are our dear friends now? Where are the beloved faces? There was a crowd of us. Now we are almost alone.
Continent! But for some, rather than sorrow, the plague brings the opportunity for looting, drinking, and brutality. In suffers overflow.
Sulle mani da lei! Quella è la mia donna! Maiale!
Quarantine historian Matteo Valani is outraged.
Men gave themselves to the most disordered and disordered behavior more than ever before. They rushed headlong into lust.
Still, the vast majority of survivors neither sink into despair nor wallow in excess. Most simply pick up and get on with the process of living. They never lose faith in God, or, even more remarkably, their faith in the future.
Medieval people also had the assumption that God would make all things right, that God had a plan, that the apocalypse would set things right in the end, or that there would be a renewal, a restoration, that this was not simply the end, there would be something that would come beyond.
What's amazing?
Nothing and no one remain the same. Everything must change. You have been listening to Before the Two Songs, them, a documentary on the Black Plague. Some reports say that 20 million people died in 2 years in that devastating disease. Now, we have to draw some similarities between then and now, and draw it even to the bigger picture of this other thing that them call Ebola too. Because meanwhile, people is going into conspiracies. As you hear that the people, them going into conspiracies. Everything that you hear the man talk about, as it relates to how the people them react to the disease, don't feel it's not the same way people react, even to this little disease as I know with chikungunya, much less if a bigger one come lick with yourself. Everything where you hear him talk about, the same way you hear people go out, the same ideas and the same blaming and the same cruelty and devil. We see that in Jamaica when hurricane come. When hurricane come, man go rob place. You know, when people in a agony, man take advantage of the agony, go rob people place and do all sorts of things. So it's not like them thing there is not something that we can look upon and say, but wait, how can we learn from those things? But you notice them say the whole world was devastated, and then them say Spain, not them say France, Italy, England, Germany. You know, they say nothing about the Caribbean and nothing about Africa and everything there. When they say the world, you know. When them say the world, you know, they include Africa, you know. Why you know that, you know? The thing with it is that here is a scourge that come upon man again. Not the first, because we said they have the talk about the AIDS thing already. But here is something, you know, will kill 4,000 odd Africans already. This is the worst it has ever been. And now, not by ships with rats now. It is not passing, it's not going across the waters with by ships will come with rat and flea, but by human beings through aeroplane. This is all the thing I travel now. The chikungunya come just all through aeroplane. Human being bring it. Just like how human being carried go to Germany, human being carried go to America, human being carried all over the place. But when it get terrible, it's that time the people start to have a lot of things to say. Where when you really check it, most of it is not that, and people don't get to the root cause. The root cause in Jamaica, where we hear now, so the St. Mary people, them no one deal with, is that they, why when we hear, we used to hear Christian talk about cleanliness is next to godliness. That means say God sit down and some cleanliness over that side and sit down beside him. It's next to him. Cleanliness should be godliness. I don't know why them are quoted that way there. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Like says him neighbor. Let's suppose him neighbor move. We are saying people must face the reality of the situation. And we must not wait on these catastrophes to examine our surroundings. I know a lot of people are listening to where you are right now. And I know, without a doubt, said that documentary have a serious effect. Yes, I know that. That documentary have a serious, serious effect.
Hey, mysteries do unfold.
You know, so we will be back here a little more from 2, click that, from 2 to 5:45 with the Stepping Razor, the Art of War, and we're going to tackle another aspect of this thing that has standing up in our face. We can't go around it, we have to face it. Yes, cutting edge.
Motor.
Yes, blessed.
A long time we not call you.
Oh, you the man weird.
Today, I know. We just turn and I hear the documentary and I say, what an appropriate documentary.
No, we did have to bring it out, man. We did have to bring it out. Trust me, we did have to bring it out.
Boy, may I tell you, Mota, and then now, why, you see, this weekend, yeah? I fret the whole of this weekend, yeah? No, because me see some incorporated out because Farrakhan come.
Yeah.
Mr. Al Faisal they sit down quiet. And who them all are coming in this evening?
Yeah,
Abu Bakr.
Yeah, they must stop him, say them not allowed to come in.
That sound like terrorists incorporated that converge upon Jamaica.
Well, we don't know still. We don't know if a terrorist a converge from Jamaica still.
I don't like. Hey, you see this ISIS thing?
Yeah.
Set up by King Abdullah to counter both the Shiite Muslim them and Al Qaeda. Al Qaeda is a CIA set up, you know.
Yeah.
Then Mr. Abdullah say. Look how we come here, come we go now, we bin Laden, and you see how we turn it in and take with a fool. Mm. So him set up him ISIS.
Yeah. Yeah. No, me hear that he go away a while ago.
No, is that serious thing?
Yeah. Well, you know, this documentary has showed some form of similarities.
You know, nobody now call you in at the night. Everybody no. Sit down a trembling.
No, is that they've not called it's me now take the call.
Well,
we don't want when me a plate, somebody come with some we out talking when we like, okay, I deal with some of them. Digest
no, but
it.
Me I tell you, in the night, I'm sit down and I see it and I feel it. Them sit down and tremble.
Yeah, well, it's that we played for. You know, the doctor yesterday say, sometimes when people fear for them life, them do something to protect them life quicker.
Yeah, man, me give thanks for your plate, man.
Yeah, man, give thanks, man. A long time we don't hear from you, though. I'm glad you still have listened to us. Mind about you book up the channel, you know, are you?
No, book up? No, man. Book up. Look here, tomorrow we call you.
All right, sir, give thanks. Yes. I mean, believe you me, I know, say, coming up, me know, say, behind some emotional weirdo. The first time I hear that, you know, I was astounded. I get up out of my bed and sit down up for just 3 years, you know, because you don't have to watch it, you know. The narrator is saying exactly, so you don't have to watch nothing. And I say, you know, say, if I play this thing, it will have the same effect on a whole heap of people. Because you know, say, one who drop asleep still, like our Brian, you know, he's not really sleep yet still, you know, but he might go watch all him, and see him with matching stick inside that, you know, like he might hold up him, he might eyelid with matching stick. I want to get a needle for hold up your eyelid. Yes, cutting edge. Yeah.
Mota.
Yes, sir.
I want to talk to you now.
Yeah, talk quick, though.
All right. I have a book
on.
That I want to get to you. The title of the book is called AIDS and Ebola. Emerging virus. I bought this book some 17 years ago.
Yes.
It's written by a scientist named Leonard Horowitz.
Yes.
He used to work at the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta.
Yes.
Now, this book, it has documented evidence that AIDS and Ebola was made. It was a thing, something that was created by a scientist that used to work for the Center of Disease Control in Atlanta.
I can tell you something, Bridget. I can tell you something. Every disease was either created by man or in create the environment for the disease to sustain itself. So the idea that man create these things is not far-fetched.
Right.
The problem I have with it is that if we keep talking about the conspiracy of the disease and don't recognize that there's things that we can do to maybe not directly eliminate it, but create an environment that the disease don't create the catastrophe like where it go on within Europe. One of the reasons why we play that thing, you know, is for sure say in Europe, in them backward times in Europe, them even though them realize a rat and flea carry the thing, them never do nothing for curtail the rat and the fly them, you know. Them start to talk about that some apocalypse and this and that. So we understand where I say I read those books and I hear the books them and I listen to the tape them, but I'm saying at this juncture where we reach now, we need to develop a thought, a thinking where what can we do to curtail, discourage, because we could have done a lot of things to curtail the chick V thing, you know, but we never prepare for it in the way that now we here we are prepared for this Ebola thing. Yeah.
Ebola, yeah.
But you still have people in Jamaica who refuse to clean up them surroundings because them say not mosquito do it.
Right, I know. I hear that argument too.
Yeah, so them have this conspiracy theory that is blinding them eyes from, all right, it's a conspiracy theory, yes, but yes or no. What are we going to do to prevent this conspiracy theory to kill 500 people when could I go kill 10 people?
Right, yeah, right, just by cleaning up your environment.
Yes, and have a serious education. We have to learn from the past, you know what I mean? I say, you see when me listen to that tape there,
right.
I learn a whole heap of things and I measure when me should have that take and when me should have said to people, you know, because, I mean, even though people say Africa backward, you know, but if you listen to that thing there, you know, you can't say, oh, Europeans were so backward.
They are more backward than the Africans.
Yeah, so we need to reach a stage.
Right.
All right.
I wasn't aware of the fact that you may have read that book already, you know, but the man that wrote that created AIDS. His name is Galileo. And yeah. They made that AIDS and Ebola. They made it in Atlanta at the Center for Disease Control.
I am told that AIDS was created in Maryland, in Fort Detrick. There's a place named Fort Detrick.
Uh-huh.
And I have a tape why I created AIDS. I have a tape right now on my computer right now. The man, when you see a man who you talk about?
Galileo, yes.
He said, why I created AIDS. And he started to explain to you the reason. Uh-huh. So, you know, those things, we are quite aware of them. I hope that people is also aware of them. And it's good that you mentioned the book.
Okay.
That you mentioned the book.
Yeah, I didn't know because I wanted to get it to you. So in if you didn't have it,
no
before,
man, bring the book. Look, Adrian, we not. I don't watch out. We used to sell them book. That some of them were me sell me not keep. You know.
Okay.
So if you know some of them have the audio book, some of me like the hardcover book. So if you want to get it to me, bring it to me. I put it in my library, man. Know what you mean, man?
Okay. All right. Where are you?
Where you are? Tell me where you is.
I am in Westmoreland, a little place called Greenfield.
You're the far. Really, I'm telling you. I think I'm coming to Westmoreland at the end of this month.
Uh-huh.
I will be at Belmont Academy at the
end. What time? Give me a date and time, and maybe I could meet you there.
It's the end of the I don't remember the day, but I know it's from 10 to 4, I'll be there. The whole day, we'll be there the whole day. If you call Belmont, I ask them. I don't remember it's the end of the month, though, the 30th.
Okay, I know the school, Belmont Academy.
Yeah, Belmont Academy. Yeah, man, I appreciate that book. Yeah, man, give thanks.
Yeah, man, it's written by a man called Leonard Horowitz. It even has the formula for making AIDS and the virus and everything.
Yes.
He was a scientist there, and when he wanted to expose the Galileo, and they fired him, and the CIA wanted to kill him. I don't know if they got him by now, but they wanted to kill him. Yeah. But anyway, I'll get the book to you somehow.
Thank you very much. You was listening to the tape up here?
Yes, man. Yes, man.
Okay, all right. Give thanks.
Every time.
Yeah, man, Harry. Yes. Yeah, man, and we appreciate the gesture, though, that people listen and speak to them can help with certain information. I just accidentally go by my email a while ago. I'm not sure, Brian, how much things did they already did. I don't understand why a man has sent one email same time. Like, him, are you sure, say, you read it? If the Lord say, I got to delete the other six, I read one. I mean, why am I to say it at the same time? There's so much. That means that the people, them are listening. You understand? That the people, them are listening. Yes.
Hello.
Yeah, blessed.
Yes, good morning, Muta.
Morning, sir.
Well, may I tell you, what are you for information, man? For the tape, yeah.
May I tell you, man?
We want to stray off of the pint, you know. We want to stick with the same tape, you know?
Yeah.
Now listen right down the 13th century, the 1347, the 1348.
Well, you remember the date? You remember the date?
I want your motor, man.
What
a piece of something, brother.
Oh, gosh, man.
I don't know. So, tomorrow, you don't think you can run it tomorrow?
No, we can't do that tomorrow. I want to tell you, no. Mm-hmm. It's more than one of them, but I have one where I edit down to 18 minutes, you know.
Yeah.
And the information there, you know, but I say, all right, since I couldn't play that one day, in the day, what I'm going to do is find the best and more comprehensive one to play today.
Yeah, man.
So it really, you know, and I say, and I love saying, well, I'm going to give the minister L to.
Are you mean? The priest man there, the Pope man.
Yes.
Clement VI.
Yes.
But the man stand up tall, see me all over.
Well, what the doctor do, you know, it's true, man, recognize a fire. Is a good thing. Him set fire right round which part the Pope, you know, the throne of the Pope, you know. But the Pope did not get too hot in the fire. Because, you know, every day he have set up round the fire. They have put fire around him, so he might get too hot. So eventually he said, no, he can't bother with that. So he left and go in our castle. and save himself. But the doctor never save himself. But the doctor studied to the point where he could have made the world know what happened when somebody have it. So he used himself as a living sacrifice, you know, which was the doctor himself. But it's really something else, you know, to consider how them, I tell you. Anyway, give thanks. Yes, I mean, I tell you, it. And the development of that disease, it almost reminds you, when you look on the picture of them with the Ebola, that's why I'm saying, you know, all of them diseases, they have something similar in them. Something similar, you know, it's like it's one disease with bully for a different name. And they know the disease them take unto itself at different perspectives. Yes, it's like a living organism. Hello. Yes.
Yeah, Uncle Mota, DJ Kev, Alabama.
Oh gosh, man, how you do, man?
You know, so I can't sleep, you know, they are playing something, I can't sleep.
No, you're not supposed to sleep. After your name, Brian, you're not supposed to sleep.
My blood goes out right now, but
no. No, you know, him go wash him face a while ago, you know. But then, no, okay. I see him with a matching stick.
Okay.
So, man, if you
hello, oh God.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, this station tonight, I really applaud you for that one tonight. Serious. You know, if I start playing, I'm pull it up and I watch it. So, like, I watch it.
At the
same time.
I'm glad to say I want the people to know.
You should
know. Which path you go find that, too. You can't go. At a YouTube, you go find.
Let me tell you my name. Black. Plague documentary HQ.
Yeah, the Black Plague. Yeah, man, the Black Plague HQ. Yeah, documentary HQ.
Yeah, documentary. But may I say, people need to understand how devastating it was to Europe, in a car. According to history.com, a website, they claim it took 75 million lives, you know.
Yeah, some people say 50 million, yeah.
That are like the whole of the whole Caribbean gone, the whole of North America gone.
No, man. Wait, man. 200 million people there in North America, you know. Yes, man. The population of America is little over 200 million people.
Yeah.
But the population of Nigeria is about 160 million, with a go maybe 200 million now. You know?
Okay, so that's about quarter.
But can you imagine hear the man say? There were places where they was burying people was dying like 600 per day, and then with other cases where 10,000 bodies were supposed to be buried. Okay, can you imagine you need to bury 10,000 bodies? Can you imagine the decaying bodies that lay down in the streets in France and in Italy? And they rat them again, come back on these things, and then spread the disease again, and it just keeps spreading.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Devastating, like he kill off everybody there, so I say, and them get superstitious now, that that's
yeah,
the man, problem coming in.
Yeah, well, that, the flag, yeah. All right, I hope people don't understand what is these people, all right. What them do is them make some leather strands of leather, and put some little ball upon the head of it. And then them flash it across them back. And beat themselves over them back till the back start bleed. And you have like hundreds of men. Them still have them, you know. Them still have them in this modern time, you know. Hundreds of men walk in the streets. And whip them back. Whip themselves till it bleed. And pure blood have run upon them. Till them get so powerful that them start to gain strength. In a Germany and in parts of Europe, to the point where now them start to declare things that don't go so. Like, you know, is that man called it born him? Is that set of people
born him? Yeah. And see them attack the Jews in all of this too as well, you know?
Yeah, so I want to say them still have them people that were doing it. Every Easter, them come out and whip themselves. Them whip them back, they start bleed. Them still have them in this modern time, yeah, man. European, them still.
Yeah, have in mind, them are start kill up black people to down there and I say, boy, you know?
Yeah, man.
But
yeah,
them, the way I right now, that's why right now it's so important. I have to do the reality of the thing. you know?
Yeah.
Palo Qual, Texas, just up the road, there's a family, there's a right, you know. And if them say the thing, here, man.
The boy are not airborne, man. It don't go airborne when it's in a plane. It's not airborne, really. It's flesh to flesh, a cause, you know. You see,
yeah.
It's not airborne thing.